Good morning, everybody, and thank you for coming here on a Sunday morning, you know, when we all like to have a relaxed early morning at home. And thank you for those nice words of introduction, Chennai Citizens Forum. Over the next 20 minutes to half an hour, I hope to take you on a, you know, on a 30,000 feet above view of what the budget is. I'm not going to go into the nitty-gritties as much as possible. I'll probably focus more on the signals from the budget and what the finance minister has attempted to do. I think Anant is going to look at a lot of the micro proposals, so I leave that to him. Over the last 1 week, you know, one question that I've been posed repeatedly at every public gathering or wherever I meet or in the relative circle or in friend circle is this a, what do you think of the budget? Is this a good budget? Is it an excellent budget? Is it a disastrous budget, as a lot of opposition members are talking about it? What is the budget like? Now, to me, the budget is certainly not an excellent budget, far from it. It's not a disastrous budget too. It is a budget that has been crafted for the times we are in. It is a budget that amply reflects the difficult situation that the economy is in now, and how the finance minister's hands were tied in doing a lot of things which could have been done, which were expected of her. You know, in the run-up to the budget, a lot of articles came in the media, not in the Hindu, of course, in several other newspapers and television channels about how, you know, the finance minister should come out with a big bang budget. You know, this big bang word is much abused. We have heard it so many times over the last few years. And the last big bang budget was 1997 when Chidambaram came up with all those, you know, tax cuts. You know, he's probably spoiled the country, spoiled the media, and every budget from then. In fact, I am sick and tired of reading this in the run-up to the budget from commentators saying there should be a big bang budget, there should be stimulus. Now, what is stimulus? Everybody is coming up with nice gratuitous advice to the finance minister, but nobody goes beyond the word stimulus. What do you expect in terms of stimulus? What do you want in terms of big bang proposal? All the easy reforms have been done. So what do you want? Now, in this background, the finance minister's attempted to craft, she's walked the thin line. It's very evident, thin line between fiscal prudence and, you know, being expansionary. This is not an expansionary budget. Let's be very clear about that. This is not an expansionary budget, despite the overrun in the fiscal deficit. The fiscal deficit, as we all know, has been overrun by, you know, 0.5 percentage points this year, and for the next year as well, the projection is 0.5 percentage points extra. Despite that, this is not a expansionary budget. Why do I say that? Now, before we get into looking at this year's budget, I think I should spend about 3-4 minutes explaining the context, what prompted this budget to be what it is like. You know, the last year's budget, which was presented, the first one of this government, in July 2019, it was marked by overambitious assumptions. You know, in an economy where the growth was already slowing down, I think in July it must have been close to 6% would have been the expectation. The projection for nominal growth rate assumed in the last budget, I'm not talking of this one, I'm talking of the one presented in July, was 12%. And what has the nominal growth rate turned out to be, at least going by the projection, the latest ones we have now, with 7.5%. So you can imagine what was projected at 12%, what is actually going to be, you know, a maximum of 7.5%. So all the numbers built based on this assumption collapsed. And the numbers were over-optimistic. They're estimated very much on the optimistic side. Tax projections, I mean tax growth projections in excess of 15%, huge disinvestment target of 1,05,000 crores. All this fell through, and GST. GST could not, the government could not garner the GST projections, and it's still struggling to meet at least a certain decent level which will help it tide over this year's revised estimates. Now, in this, why was this the case? Because growth collapsed. We all know how growth fell literally off the cliff in the last 6 months, and we're now looking at 5% or even less than 5% for this fiscal year as the GDP growth rate. Because of that, tax revenue projections fell, tax collections fell, GST collections fell, and revenue growth was running about 3 lakh crores on a budget of say 16-15 lakh crores. 3 lakh crores was the deficit in revenue projections, the collections, of which I think direct taxes alone accounted for 1.8 lakh crore. Both corporate taxes and personal income tax collections are dropping. Now, it is in this context that the finance minister sat down to produce this year's budget. And what did she do? She, I think this started even before the budget, from the last quarter, the December, November, December onwards itself. The government went on a cost-cutting spree. If you look at the budget projections for expenditure last year and what has actually been spent this year, even in some of the most important schemes of the government, the flagship schemes of the government, like the Ayushman Bharat or the NREGA, which Dr. Ram Kumar referred to, the actual expenditure is much below what was budgeted for. For instance, in NREGA, the budgeted amount, last budget I'm talking of, was 75,000 crores. And what was the actual expenditure? The revised estimate of expenditure is about 67,000 crores only. Ditto with several other schemes. I can read out a laundry list of schemes which are very close to the Prime Minister's heart. Despite that, the expenditure on those schemes has been lower. For instance, the much touted Swachh Bharat mission, the outlay on that in Swachh Bharat urban was 2650 crores in the last budget. They spent only 1300 crores. Similarly with Swachh Bharat Grameen, 9900 crores. The actual amount spent was 8300 crores. Ayushman Bharat, which was brought last year in the election budget and which probably helped the BJP with a lot of votes in the hinterland. I think it was the budget before that, if I'm right, not the election budget. 6,500 crores was the projection. And the government ended up spending half of that. 3,314 crores is what they spent, as per the revised estimates in this year. Pradhan Mantri Kisan, this was introduced in the last budget. 2,000 rupees Sanman to all, every farmer a quarter. 75,000 crores was the budgeted amount. And what did the government spend? It spent only 54,370 crores. So farmers were not paid, are not being paid the promised amount. Now, this is, according to me, a vicious cut in expenditure, but necessitated by the realities. The government had to do this because revenues were not coming in. So this fiscal deficit overrun, which I was talking about, the 0.5 percentage points overrun. In the budget run-up, a lot of people wanted the finance minister to ignore the fiscal deficit target, go out and spend. It's okay if the fiscal deficit target is breached. You use the money to give a stimulus to the economy. In the event, the finance minister did breach the target, but it was not for giving a stimulus. It was only to balance her books for the last year. That is how difficult the situation is right now. Now, let's look at this year's numbers. You know, despite this, all this, I should say, credit should be given for some realistic assumptions in this year's budget, except for the nominal GDP growth, which again, I feel is a little on the optimistic side at 10%. 12% last year, assumption, 7.5% actual, and this year, the assumption is 10%. Now, this budget is crafted on three pillars, if you ask me. One is, of course, of growth returning to the economy, which is why you have a 10% nominal GDP growth assumption. The second is a huge, ambitious disinvestment stroke privatization target of 2,10,000 crores. The third is 1,38,000 crore. Revenue assumed from the telecom sector. So the non-tax revenues, these two alone account for about 3.5 lakh crores. And that's to give you the importance of these two sums, these two heads on which revenue has been assumed. These two account for 11% of total revenues budgeted for this year. Now you can understand what will happen if either the disinvestment process doesn't proceed as per plan, God forbid, or if the telecom industry, which is already in whole lot of trouble, is not able to pay up its dues. Now this 1.38 lakh crores or 1.33 lakh crores assumed from the telecom sector includes license fees, it includes dividends, it also includes apparently the dues payable as per the Supreme Court order on aggregate gross revenues, which the telecom industry lost. Now in the post budget briefings, the secretaries have been at pain to clarify that no, this does not include the AGR dues. We are not accounted for it because it's still in it's sub judice, so we are not accounted for it. But then the numbers don't match up. If you take him for his word, where is the extra money for 1.38 lakh crores? The actual revenue should have been more in the 60,000 crore range. Where is the balance 75,000-80,000 crores coming from? Now we don't know that. So this is the three pillars on which the budget is resting. Now if you look at revenues, tax revenues, tax buoyancy of about 1.2, which means she's assumed 12% growth in taxes, direct taxes. Now 12% growth is in ordinary times not a bad target, but in the current context when corporate growth rates are falling, net profits reported by all the major listed companies is either tapered or falling. Now how do you expect a 12% growth in corporate tax collections? Personal income tax is very easy, you know, they'll squeeze us, you don't have a choice, TDS is deducted and the money goes. But what about corporate taxes? Where is the money going to come from, especially in an environment where you cut tax rates 22% for companies and 15% for new companies, existing companies and new companies. Now with a tax rate cut, with the economy slowing down, with profit growths not being what they should be, a 12% assumption of direct tax revenues, to my mind, appears a trifle ambitious. On the expenditure side, credit should be given that despite all this, the budget looks very decent in terms of its allocations. Yes, last year the actual expenditure, the revised estimates for most of the schemes, social sector schemes, are lower, but this year they are bouncing back to what was budgeted for last year. At least they are meeting the same budget targets of the last budget. We have to wait and watch whether the expenditure goes as per plan, but the budget is built for that. 13% growth in expenditure is the assumption, if I'm right. And the best part about this expenditure is that qualitatively, it's a major improvement over the last budget. Capital expenditure, depending on how you look at it, which way you slice and dice it, is either 18% or 22% up compared to last year. 18% up over the revised estimates of last year, 22% up over the budgeted estimates, which is excellent. Which means the government is spending on asset creation, which will bring in jobs, which will bring in revenues, which will also be an impulse to GDP growth in the future. In this capital expenditure, while being on the expenditure subject, I need to point out something. One common habit of governments, not just this one, the previous one, the Congress governments, has always been to meet budget deficit targets, either to postpone expenditure to the next year, accounting in terms of accounting, or borrow from the PSUs, get the PSUs to borrow and take that money, which was employed in the last year by this government. Food Corporation of India's balance sheet was leveraged. And this year again it's happened. The National Small Savings Fund is being used, and it's been used consistently over the last 4-5 years. If you look at the numbers, I'll just read out the money taken from the small savings schemes. The fiscal deficit has been financed over the last 2 years, to an extent of about 1.25 lakh crores from securities against small savings. And last budget and this budget, again, the assumption is 2.4 lakh crores. So what you're doing is, these are extra budgetary resources which conceal the actual fiscal deficit figure. You're saying you overran the fiscal deficit by 0.5 percentage points. You add this and the national small savings borrowings, it comes to about roughly about 0.7% of the GDP. So the actual fiscal deficit this year is more likely to be in the range of 4.5%. And we are talking of only the center. To get a clear picture, you need to take into account state's fiscal deficit also. Now you add that, God knows, it may be 7%, 8% closer to that mark. So this is something which has to be curbed. To the credit of this government and the finance minister, she's being transparent about it. She's not trying to hide, mask these numbers or hide these numbers in the voluminous documents. There's a separate annexure which she's given. She's mentioned it in a budget speech as well, which clearly shows how much has been borrowed from the NSSF and other schemes and how much the fiscal deficit will go up because of this. Now, this is so far as expenditure goes, and receipts, I already told you about it. Now, let me move on to some of the features of this budget. Now, there are some very interesting features. The sad part is, you know, a 2.5 hour speech, it buries all the important stuff. The first one hour and 15 minutes was inane stuff. You should have looked at the markets when the speech was going on. The Sensex did not know how to react. It was flat, 100 points. It didn't know which way to go. The best part of the budget was in the part B, which came very late in the finance minister's speech. It's one agrees that the budget is the one time when the government does a grandstanding in front of the entire country. It has to speak about all its achievements, all the ministries concerned. But then can't we have a balance? Can't we have a balance where we have just a 1 hour crisp budget speech, where the first 15-20 minutes is devoted to political aspects, whatever the government wants to talk about. The remaining half an hour, 40 minutes for the core budget, the numbers which matter, the proposals that matter. This is something that probably, maybe Anand can bring this up in the PMEAC. We should probably have two speeches from the government every year. One is the budget, another State of the Union address, like what we have in the US. In the State of the Union address, let the Prime Minister talk about all the achievements that his government has done. Let it be a political speech. Let the budget be the more sensible stuff, the more important stuff that we can talk about. What has happened is, because of this 2.5 hour speech, as I said, some of the more interesting proposals, which could have been classified as a big bang proposal, got buried. The abolition of dividend distribution tax, which is a very important reform. You are taxing dividends twice, sometimes thrice, if you are a high net worth individual in the earlier system. Regressive. It's not fair to tax the same money twice, right? So this is a more classical system where you revert to taxing dividends in the hands of the shareholder, the individual assessee. Now, this has minus points as well. Ease of collection was there when it was taxed in the hands of the companies. Here, you have to ensure that each assessee is truthful about its disclosure. But then today, with all the technology and artificial intelligence that the Income Tax Department is deploying, the finance minister said that, very interesting, ATG, which is much abused, henceforth, the list of donees will be self-populated in your assessment when you file the return. There's no scope for fictitious donees to come into the picture. I cannot say I donated to XYZ Charitable Trust, which is not registered on the Income Tax Act, and claim a deduction, which is excellent. You know, technology being deployed. This government has to be acknowledged, has deployed technology excellently in income tax and revenue departments. Faceless assessments, which she spoke about last year and which is gathering pace, is a very good way forward. And, you know, it has to be acknowledged that it will help control, should I say, corruption at the lower and middle ends of the system, which is the most difficult to manage. Now, if I'm filing my return from Chennai, I may be assessed by somebody sitting in Guwahati. He doesn't know who I am. I don't know who he is. And if I'm called for, if my return is picked up for scrutiny and I'm called for further clarifications, it may go to an officer sitting in Shimla or Jammu and Kashmir. Where is the scope for underhand dealings here? Absolutely zero. So this is technology leveraging by this government has been outstanding. And that's going to have an impact in tax collections as we move forward for sure. Now, DDT, I was telling you about DDT. a small aside here, you know, this government, the Modi government, whether it's the first term or the second term, obviously does not believe in big bang announcements in the budget. If you look at, I think there must have been about 7-8 budgets presented by Modi 1 and Modi 2.0. Of the 8 budgets, how many budgets had big reform measures that you can think of? None. All the reform measures have been done outside the budget, whether it's GST, whether it is a corporate tax cut, whether it is demonetization. I don't know whether demonetization is a reform, but let's assuming it can be classified as a reform measure. A lot of the bank recapitalizations announced, which were front loaded by the finance minister last year, everything has been done. The IBC, it has been done outside the budget. The IBC was a passing reference by Mr. Jaitley's budget speech in 2016 or 2015, if I'm right. But other than that, the budgets have been fairly, you know, even Stevens, you know, average stuff, which you forget about the next day. But this budget is one that has been growing on you. Over the last 1 week, I've been seeing that newer facets are coming out as I delve deeper into the numbers and, look at some of the stuff. So DDT is one. The second thing that she's done very well is deposit insurance coverage. You know, this is something that touches every individual in the context of failures of some cooperative banks last year. Deposit insurance has been increased from 1 lakh to 5 lakhs, as you all know, which is a very, very good measure. Of course, we need to watch who's going to bear the extra premium, how is it going to be financed by the balance sheets or the banks. That's something to be worried about for later. But as a measure that sends out a strong signal of this government's commitment to the private citizen, increase in insurance coverage for deposits is an excellent measure. The other one which everybody is talking about, the talking point of this budget actually, has been the new system of personal income taxation, where you graduate from higher rates with exemptions, myriad exemptions, to lower rates with almost no exemption available. This is, the government said, has released about 40,000 crores into the economy. That's someone that the government thinks it's sacrificing, though my own assumption may be much lower, going by how this number will be incumbent on, it rests on how many people actually take the benefit of this scheme and move to the smaller one, the lower tax regime. So it could be 40,000 crores at the maximum, but I think it will be lower than that, going by the reactions in the first week from people. People are, flummoxed totally on what this is, whether, this is going to help them, this is not going to help them. It's good business for my tribe, chartered accountants. But that said, this is a reform measure too. If you look at one aspect in the last year and a half, there has been a conscious attempt to drive down tax rates in the economy. Corporate tax rate was cut, income tax rate is now cut, and import duties, there has been in this budget a lot of products where import duties have been hiked, but there have been products also where import duties have been cut. So the government is moving towards a lesser tax economy. That's very evident. It's a work in progress. It cannot happen overnight. This country, you cannot cut rates overnight like what the United States does and say, okay, this is what, take it. This has to happen step by step, in marginal steps, which is the same way to go forward, and this is happening. I said this budget rests on three pillars. We spoke about growth. Possibly I'll have a few words to say at the end on whether we can expect a 10% nominal growth rate this year. I spoke about disinvestment. Now let's talk about LIC in particular. We are talking of, the details are not clear yet, but the talk going in the corridors is 5 to 10% disinvestment in Life Insurance Corporation of India. The Prime Minister, the Finance Minister spoke about it at 1:30 in the afternoon on February 1. By 4 o'clock, I got a message from a particular employee of LIC saying, we are going on walkout protest at 4:30. So that gives an indication of the opposition, the likely opposition to this disinvestment proposal, which is very crucial for the government's budget numbers. On the good side, we have to look at, see, disinvestment of LIC can be seen at one level as raising money to fill the fiscal hole. At another level, it should be, which is how I would say it should be viewed, It should be viewed as a reform measure which brings in much required transparency into LIC's functioning, LIC or any other organization where the disinvestment happens. It brings in much required transparency. When LIC is listed in the stock exchanges, the amount of disclosure that the company has to come up with is multifold over what it is now. You cannot have an opaque system where the government tells LIC, okay, I'm in trouble, this bank is in trouble, please go buy it. And lo and behold, one fine morning, IDBI is your subsidiary, right? That cannot happen in this environment where, of course, there have been cases where a lot of PSUs, disinvested PSUs, especially in the oil sector, which are listed in the stock markets, have been used by the government. ONGC is a classic example, which is listed in the stock exchanges, which was forced to go buy equity in Hindustan Petroleum. Now, these things do happen, but they'll largely be the scope for the government to play around with public sector units will be much lesser when they are listed on the stock exchanges. When there are foreign institutions holding a stake, they'll question the government at the AGM, behind the AGM, you know, in the corridors of North Block. Questions will be raised. So it should be seen as a reform measure. It is good. And when you say disinvestment, we should make a clear distinction here. The common misperception that I've been seeing in the last 1 week is LIC is going to be privatized. Oh my God, it'll become a private company. What will happen to all the policies that have been issued by this organization? There's a sovereign guarantee behind each of these policies. Will the sovereign guarantee stand? No, it's wrong. Please don't think of it as privatization. It's only disinvestment. Privatization is when the company is sold to a private investor, lock, stock and barrel, or at least 51% is sold. Here, we are talking of a 5 or 10% at the most. And even this, the markets today may not have the depth to absorb this kind of a float. Remember, the government has lined up several other privatization and disinvestment deals. There's Bharat Petroleum, there's Container Corporation, a whole lot of companies that are, you know, following IDBI, whole lot of disinvestment coming. So if LIC comes in and mops up all the money in the market, how will the other disinvestment candidates fare? So this will obviously be a factor while deciding how much to sell from LIC. And even assuming they sell 10%, I don't think there is any fear of LIC being privatized. And if you're saying what happens when it's eventually privatized, I don't think it's a near-term possibility. I don't see LIC becoming a private company at least for the next decade. It's not going to happen. It's not such an easy job to do. So the fears on LIC have been largely misplaced, whipped up for political reasons. I think it's a good idea to privatize, disinvest from LIC. On the one side, it helps the government earn some money to fill up its budget hole. On the other side, it brings in much needed reform in one of the largest PSUs in this country, which holds massive assets across the economy, across the corporate sector. So the importance of LIC can never be understated. The finance minister also did some excellent maneuvering in the debt markets. You know, this is again something that has largely gone under the radar in the last 1 week. People have not noticed it. On the day when the budget was presented, soon after she finished her budget speech, yields on bonds fell. Why did they fall? And over the last 1 week, they have been falling. They fell much more after the monetary policy, which was announced on Thursday. But why did yields fall? Because there are two or three proposals that she's brought in, which are revolutionary to my mind. You know, last year, the budget had a proposal for a sovereign bond, which created a lot of flutter and people writing against it, including Raghuram Rajan saying this is a lousy idea. Why is the government doing this? All that was spoken about. So the government quietly shelved that. But very few notice that the foreigners, aspect of foreigners holding bonds has come back quietly in this budget in a very inconspicuous proposal, where some category of non-resident investors will be allowed to invest in government securities. Now, what is a non-resident investor? A non-resident investor can be a non-resident Indian, but it can also be a foreigner. So these investors will hold government securities. Now, is this not foreign holding? I mean, I'm not saying this is a bad idea, but look at how beautifully this has been done. The other thing is, sovereign wealth funds have been given a lot of tax breaks on dividends, on profits, on other things. If they invest in infrastructure, which again is a brilliant idea, sovereign wealth funds have a lot of money, and money is already always floating around hunting for the best opportunity in the world. And India is a great opportunity despite the slow growth we are witnessing right now. A 1.3 billion population, a consumerist culture has to grow, and sovereign wealth funds cannot ignore India. And by giving them tax breaks, and importantly specifying this will be only for infrastructure, you're keeping them away from the sensitive sectors of the economy where you don't want them to come in and buy out your marquee companies and businesses. It's only for infrastructure investment. So you're giving them tax breaks to do that. And I'm sure you're going to see a lot of activity on this front in the next 1 year. Possibly this is also based on feedback that the government has received from sovereign wealth funds over the last few months, which is why this proposal has been brought in the first place. The bond ETF which the government brought in a couple of months ago proved to be a major success. So she's now talking of getting private investment, individual investors into G-Sec through the ETF route. So we'll have a ETF for G-Sec, which is again an interesting proposal. Finally, before I wind up, I want to just focus on, by the way, I spoke about tax rates being driven down across the economy. I forgot to mention how cooperatives have now been extended the 22% benefit of 22% tax less compared to what is right now. And also power generation companies have been extended this benefit again from this year. So coming back to the final point that I wanted to make on import duties, the annexure to the budget's documents has a long laundry list of products where the finance ministers adjusted import duties, mostly upwards, sometimes downwards. What are the products on which duties have gone up? Ranging from the humble comb, which we use every day, to toys, to solar power equipment, to batteries used in electric cars, electric vehicles, completely knocked down kits of electric vehicles. On everything, import duties have gone up. Even on the humble, walnut, it's now 100% duty. Talking of walnut, there's an interesting sidelight to this proposal. The focus of this government on Kashmir comes through in this. Walnut is a major product of Kashmir, as we all know. And walnut is also imported in large quantities from the United States and other places. So by imposing 100% import duty, the finance minister has probably tried to address the farmers, walnut farmers of Kashmir. There's another Kashmir proposal which is also buried in the fine print in the import duty structure. The government gives a concessional 3% rebate for certain products which are exported out of India. You can import up to 3% of the value at concessional or zero rate of duties. One particular product that has been included in that item, in that list this year, is willow. And we all know where willow grows the most, Kashmir. So Kashmiri industry, which produces bats, cricket bats, Kashmiri willow is much sought after for cricket bats. And right now that industry is concentrated in Punjab, Jalandhar. Now, probably aimed at giving leg up to the willow industry in Kashmir, this proposal has been brought in. This is my guess. I'm not sure if that is so much thought has gone into it. It's quite possible it has been. Now, talking of import duties again, the one criticism that one has been hearing in the last 1 week is that we are turning protectionist again. By imposing so many duties on products, for driving up costs in the economy for people who want to import this. Yes, it is a protectionist move. Yes, it could increase costs. But there are only two points that I want to highlight here. One, this aspect of costs can be temporary only till an Indian entrepreneur or an Indian businessman finds it profitable to invest in a facility to produce these products. That's one. Two, in a globe where everybody is turning protectionist, every country is turning protectionist, can India alone be the exception? And if it remains an exception, what happens to your economy? And we all know how we have been facing dumping of goods from China. Dumping is one aspect. Even you know, legal imports, our trade balance with China is extremely adverse. We import more from China than what we export, considerably more than what we export. So this being the case, and we all know how Chinese companies are dominating the mobile space today. They assemble all the mobile phones in this country with parts imported from either from China or from Taiwan, their own network. So with electric vehicles, which are now coming in a big way, the government wants to go electric in the next 5 years, 6 years, 10 years. That's a different story altogether. It has a lot of pluses and minuses. We need to assess them separately. But again, there, a lot of Chinese companies are making a beeline into India. They would like to import all their automobiles here in CKD condition or SKD condition and assemble them here in screwdriver technology and then sell it to you. The aspect here about electric is, it's all right to say we'll move away from fossil fuel. We are dependent on the Gulf countries and our import bill is going up. How are electric vehicles going to be run? It's based on lithium-ion batteries. And where is lithium-ion? China is one of the biggest holders of lithium-ion reserves in the world. One particular company, BYD, Build Your Dreams, which is based in Shenzhen, owns 7% of lithium-ion resources in the world. One company owns 7%. So you can imagine what kind of threat this is to a country which is going to go completely electric. You're going to be dependent instead of the Gulf on China. That's something we need to keep in mind. So I think this import duty measure is possibly required as at this moment, but I only hope that this will be reviewed at a particular point in time. This should not remain on the statute books forever. We should have a dynamic duty structure which looks at present conditions, prevailing conditions, and accordingly adjust them to reflect realities. While this is what I say about the budget, possibly I'll say this is a realistic budget. It could have been a big bang one, but given the background which I referred to in the early part of the speech, how revenues this year have been completely falling, and expenditure despite the compression is a fiscal deficit of 3.8 overrun. So she could not have done much more than this is what I feel. Possibly if the economy grows from here, which I think is a possibility going by, we are seeing certain green shoots in some places, though we'll have to wait and watch how they develop. I would think that we are in the stage of a Tamil letter pa. We have reached the bottom. We are now traveling the flat surface before the growth starts. So I think in the next 3 quarters, we should see a return of growth in this country, which will make these budget numbers even more achievable. Finally, to end, I would like to refer to one point, which is again something that has been hidden away in the budget speech. She spoke about Vivad Se Vishwas scheme. You know, we had a similar scheme running for GST from December to January, which proved to be a major success. And now she's talking of a Vivad Se Vishwas scheme for direct taxes. And the scheme will run until June, but if you pay up your dues before 31st March, there'll be no questions asked. You pay only your tax dues, no interest, no penalty to be paid. If you pay after March 31st, a certain extra sum which is not specified yet has to be paid, but still the scheme runs till June. Now this is what I would think, there are a lot of accountants in this crowd. I would think accountants have something called a secret reserves in their balance sheet sometimes. This is a secret reserve that has been put in place by this budget. Because the amount that we are talking about, amount in dispute, is about 9 lakh crores of rupees. 9 lakh crores. Assuming even 25% or even 20% of that comes through before 31st March this year, under the Vivad Se Vishwas scheme. I'm sure a lot of the income tax department officials are now pursuing these cases vigorously to get them to the table and pay up their dues before 31st March. If that happens, you're talking of a 2 lakh crore or 2.5 lakh crore at the optimistic end coming in before 31st March, and what will this do to your budget? Just think about it. You will not need the 0.5 percentage point extra which you got, and look at what this will do to the next year's budget also. It will free up the hands of the government tremendously. So that's something which we need to keep in mind, and one only hopes that the Vivad Se Vishwas scheme succeeds like the GST's scheme, which will be a tremendous boost to the finances of the government.